No, 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 I was gonna say this complete round, so, okay.
Little strip mall, I made the last year, little strip mall on the side of the cell.
You know, I'm not talking for my dad's mom left there.
That's what I said, and then there's a big shopping center, and there's a huge main area.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I'm surprised down there.
Yes.
I
Thank you. of Bob McConnell.
Say which is absolutely better because inform an opinion.
Friends Central in fifth grade. Please don't blame me for saying this, but I felt Friends Central's math problems were somehow easier than the Chinese ones. But I don't know how, because they were about the same topics, equations, fractions, and some geometry. But I found the answer to this question at the beginning of this year by doing many Chinese math worksheets for fun during my free time and having many discussions about this topic with my father. Yeah, I got this. So, as you can see, this on the left side, this typical Chinese math worksheet, it's got many word problems in it. And this is an advantage they have over our middle school math curriculum here at Friends Central, because word problems are extremely important. They make you practice three useful skills in math. The first skill is a skill to read or understand the problem, which you identify the answer you want to find and the crucial information for you to find the answer. And the second skill is to arrange those crucial information you found into mathematical expression, like that. And the final skill is to solve the mathematical expression from the second skill, which you use algebra skill and stuff. Unlike word problems, what I call plain or normal problems, you only get to practice the third skill, which is solving the problem. But we need the other two skills too, because when we go to work after college, no one is going to put a, yes, a business paper into a mathematical expression for us to solve. Now you might think that I'm trying to prove that Chinese curricula are better and are better for the students than our middle school curriculum here at Friends Central. But I personally prefer our curriculum more and many other Chinese students when I read it, because the Chinese teachers have made word problems so overcomplicated and is unnecessarily hard. With multiple parts to solve, uniconversions, and other brain tricks. And I'll give you an example of a uniconversion trap. So an hour is 60 minutes, a minute is 60 seconds, so for the 4 hour and 45 minutes converted into a unit of hour. So if you put down 4.45 hours, then it's like you fall into the trap of your teacher. Because the relationship between an hour and minutes is 60 and not 10, therefore the correct answer would be 4.75 hours. So each day, Chinese students have got many math homeworks to do, and each day they just it needs to solve word problems, including traps like these, and it could be very stressful. And this could result in like many kids who really have math talents, but don't want to have a math-related career. Will be like, I'm now doing these dreadful word problems, but I don't want to do these later every day in my life. It's like terrible. And I'm sure these kids must have been excellent mathematicians of China, but they lost that opportunity. So it's kind of sad. That's the disadvantage. So that's
and I've been playing for about 8 years, so I hope you enjoy. Hello everyone, my name is Melania. I will be singing A Million Dreams from A Greatest Showman.
Thank you. great concert in tennis. And after that, I do a short part of a dance with my brother Yanni. Now, the Greek Pontian Genocide took place between 1913 and 1923, and was Turkey's, or the Ottoman Empire's, way of systematically wiping off its Christian minority, which included the Pontian Greeks, non-Pontian Greeks, Assyrians, and Armenians. By late 1922, most Ottoman Greeks had rather fled from Turkey to escape the genocide, or had been killed by it. Now, this genocide only ended in 1923 after the population exchange between Turkey and it is estimated that around 353,000 Pontian Greeks alone were killed during the genocide. And other further estimates show that 3.5 million people were slaughtered after including the Assyrians, Armenians, and non-Pontian Greeks affected by the genocide. Now, obviously, one way people commemorate the genocide after 100 years is through attending memorial services. However, people like me and my brother over here, we do dances to honor the fall. And before we dance, my brother has something to say. According to the United Nations, there are 8 steps in a genocide. The very last step is admittance. And if a country does not admit the genocide, the genocide is never ending. Today, in 2019, the state of Turkey does not admit this genocide. Therefore, the genocide has not ended for over 100 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. My name is Will. I came to Friend Central in 7th grade, so last year. Now, whether you've heard me talk about how much a joke the Flyers are, or you've seen one of my Instagram posts, you know that I love hockey a lot. And this is what I decided to do for my showcase presentation. So, the history of the game. In the 1700s, stick and ball games were very popular and very common between Europe and Britain. And when British soldiers would go to Canada, they would bring these ball games with them. Because Canada is very cold, they'd play them on ice. This would eventually evolve into hockey. Now, many people do claim that modern hockey was invented in Windsor, Nova Scotia, Canada. Here are some common misconceptions about hockey. Fighting is allowed and unregulated. Now, fighting is only, it's semi-allowed once you get into the professional level, like in college, you'll get a suspension, but you do get a 5-minute penalty, and obviously, if I were to start fighting my league, I'd probably be suspended, maybe even kicked out. It is a violent and reckless sport. This is not true, although there are things like checking where you kind of run into an opponent to get the puck from them. This is very regulated. There's rules, for example, you cannot lead to a check for elbow, you cannot check something from behind, and there's a certain amount of strides you can take with your skate to before you can check. So, although there are some people would consider violent moves in hockey, not really at all violent, and as in any other sport, there are penalties. And yeah, the third misconception, all hockey players are from Canada. Now, this is somewhat true, although a lot are from Canada. There's also a lot from, obviously, the USA, Slovakia, Czech Republic, Finland, Sweden, Russia, even a country like Kazakhstan has some hockey players coming to the U.S. to play in the NHL. Last misconception, hockey is an easy sport to play. Now, I will admit that learning to skate is something that's kind of easy. You can easily teach yourself how to learn to skate. But if you were to try and teach yourself how to learn to skate in the situation you'd be in a hockey game, not even just a game, just in practice, and like, learn to skate and shoot, it's very hard. It takes a lot of time, a lot of dedication, and something that you take years to really do right. Okay, there you go. What hockey means to me, here are some pictures from last year. So hockey means a lot to me because it was the first sport that I really started to begin taking seriously. My dad put me on skates when I was around 5 years old, and I've never really stopped since. I've always taken it seriously. I played my first club team when I was in 7th grade. I played in my first actual team when I was in 3rd grade. And yeah, it's just uphill ever since. It's been easy ever since. So here are the positions in hockey. You have the goaltender, who are in the crease. You have the wings, which are right and left. And you have the center. The center is the one taking the faceoff. And the defenseman, he is the one who's supposed to kind of keep the puck away from the goalie. And yeah, thank you for listening.
Turn on your favorite night light. And today I'll be performing a piece called Summer by Joe Sayashi. I'll be playing piano accompanied by myself on recordings of cello and drums. Last year my brother did something really similar to this for his showcase. He played a song called River Flows in You by Yuruma, if you guys heard of it. I think it's pretty popular. And he played it really well. He learned the song two summers ago at a hagwon, which is a sort of Korean summer school sort of thing. But what you may not know is that my sister and I were also playing piano at that hagwon. My sister learned Under the Sea from The Little Mermaid, and I learned this song. So how many of you guys have heard of the Studio Ghibli or Miyazaki movies? Raise your hand. Yeah, Totoro, Castle Sky, stuff like that. So Joe Sayashi actually composed most of the musical tracks for those movies, so that's really nice. This piece in question comes from a movie called Hikujiro, which is about a young boy who goes on an adventure with a man. I've never seen it, if it's okay. But yeah, with summer coming up around the corner, I thought I'd just play the piece for you all. Thank you. Thank you.
Coleman. I paint fences in kindergarten.
This is a rap video. My part of it was I filmed and edited it.
I rap.
Let it be better videos, which I've seen in the background. I did this video as well. Thank you. and I started sign language this year. I decided to do sign language for my showcase because I learned some lessons in St. Louis. I thought it would be an interesting language to talk about because I feel like more people would feel inclusive. Thank you for listening. I hope you learned something.
Cold from the Addams Family musical. It's in the moments when you're left alone. why music is a universal language. So music can cause emotion, and it can comfort people, but it can do so much more. It can convey emotion, communicate it. And this communication can be understood no matter what's background. Even different species understand music. Okay, so first let's establish music as a language. According to Merriam-Webster, a language is a systematic means of communicating ideas or feelings. So when you break language down, it has five major components. In this section, I'll go through each of those components from the most basic to the most complex. First is phonetics. Phonetics is the basic sounds of language. For example, the letters A, B, and C makes the sounds A, B, and C. In music, it's notes. Okay, next is morphology. Morphology is a combination of these sounds to make a word. In music, it's a combination of notes to make a phrase. An example of this would be scale. Okay, next is syntax. Syntax is probably the most well-known out of five components. Syntax is the structure of a sentence. When I speak, I say music is a universal language. But if I were Yoda, I would say universal language music is. Okay, and music order matters. You want to end your phrases on certain notes so the phrase sounds complete. You don't have to, but it sounds better if you do. Next is semantics. Semantics is a pure meaning of a phrase. It's word for word what it means. No punctuation, no articulation, no tone, nothing. It's really boring. It's like talking to someone with a monotone. They're really boring to listen to you, and half the time you fall asleep. So here's an excerpt I'm playing with the student currently without any of the rhythm, or the dynamics, or the articulation, or the ornaments. It's really boring to listen to it. It's really quite no fun. It's so slow and boring. Like, who wants to listen to that during, like, a whole hour of a concert, right? So next is pragmatics. Pragmatics is everything semantics lacks added back in. So it's a tone, articulation, everything I was talking about before. Added back in. It's the finished part of language. It's what makes music interesting. So here's that same excerpt that you just listened to like a couple seconds ago with everything added back in. Listen to it now, how much more entertaining it is. Over whether there should be a universal language. I was on the side arguing there should be. I lost that debate, still a bit mad about it. But anyway, moving on. So, what is a universal language? A universal language is a kind of expression that is understood everywhere. So, a universal language, as I mentioned before, music conveys emotion. That emotion can be understood anywhere. If you hear a piece in E flat minor, which is a deaf key, the inevitable reaction is to feel sad. I took a poll. I played a piece, which happened to be a funeral march, and 100% of people who replied said it left them feeling sad. On the contrary, if I played a piece in D major, which is known as the happy key, the general response would be one of happiness and rejuvenation. This understanding of music has gone beyond humans, though. As shown before with the dancing parrot, that animals also understand music, making it truly universal, meaning giving us a way to communicate with animals in the future. So now, as my presentation comes to a close, even though I lost a debate in fifth grade, I hope that all of you believe that a universal language is now in existence. Thank you.
Now, this song kind of holds a special meaning in this community because it was actually written by a FCS graduate. His name was Benj Pasek, and he graduated here in 2003. And I'm now going to be singing a song that he wrote. I've learned to slam on the brakes. before I leave with the worst of me. Give them no reason to stare. No slipping up if you slip away. So I've got nothing to share. No, I've got nothing to say.
Thank you. piano.
Yeah.
My name is Jace. I'm accompanied by my little brother Kate over there. Say hi.
Hi, everyone.
We're going to be playing House of the Rising Sun by the Animals. Hope you enjoy it.
A house and you crawling
throughout all of our years at Friends Central.
We'd like to thank our very first cooperating with us and putting us with us constantly taking photos of you guys.
We also want to give a special thanks to Mr. Terrell.
Without your help, this video would not be possible. Hope you enjoy.
I didn't know. Don't grab you by the wrist, direct you where to go. So make the best of this test and don't ask why. It's not a question but a lesson learned in time. It's something unpredictable, but in the end it's right. I hope you had the time of your life. So take the photographs and still brings in your mind. Hanging on a shelf in good up and good time. Tattoos and memories and this skin on trial. For what it's worth, and it's worth all the while. It's unpredictable, but in the end it's right. I hope you have the time of your life.
For being a warm and loving community.